grandmother's house, helping my grandmother move her furniture around. She became a mother figure after the death of my mother when I was a young child, and I had been staying with her ever since my car accident. My grandmother helped nurse me back into health, so I made an effort to alleviate her of any and all physical tasks. I felt it was the least I could do. I was in the attic his way of coping with being in a strange place and settling in. The move to Castlewood was somewhat unexpected. My job had offered the chance of a transfer, along with a sizable promotion. It was too good of a deal to pass up. The drawback was, of course, that the abrupt change had left very little time for my child and my wife to acclimate to our new surroundings. "He's okay," Luke said. I glanced up at Luke. "Just okay. That's too bad. What did good old Reggie have to say?" "Nothing much," Luke said, slurping milk from a spoon. "Just stuff." "Just stuff," I parroted. "Yeah, he says he doesn't like you." I feigned distress. "No, Reggie, you wound me." I tickled Luke lightly, which resulted in a round of giggles. "Well, perhaps I can meet Reggie officially at your birthday party next weekend, and he will realize I'm not such a bad guy." My son laughed brightly and responded nonchalantly, "That's silly, Dad. Reggie can't come. He's dead." I heard the spatula my wife was holding clatter onto the stove. We both locked eyes. I paused for a beat before responding. "You say Reggie's dead?" I finally asked, looking back to my son. "Sure, he's been dead for a long time," my son responded before spooning another mouthful of Cheerios into his mouth. "Mom, can I go play out in the garden now? I finished almost a whole bowl." Claire looked slightly distracted before she nodded slightly to Luke. "Yes, but make sure to bring your bowl into the sink first." "Yes, Mom," Luke shouted, already running his half full bowl of cereal in the sink. He dashed out in the back garden without a second look back. I stared at his retreating figure. "What do you think all that was about?" I asked my wife. "I don't know. Quite creepy, don't you think?" she responded. "Quite. I don't know how he could have concocted such a story, to be honest. Think there's something to it?" Claire shot a look of disdain my way. "Are you asking me if there's a ghost hunting our house and he visits our son at night?" "Really, John?" "What, you don't believe in ghosts?" "Of course not. It's a lot of crap. Please don't tell me you actually believe in that nonsense." "I don't know," I said with a look of contemplation. "I think there's a lot in the universe that we don't understand. Who's to say there's not something after death?" She turned back to the eggs. She was still cooking. "That's ridiculous, John. Anyway, as you should have said before many times, it's just a harmless imaginary friend." "Right." She looked back over shoulder at me. "Right," I muttered, only half listening at this point. My mind was on other matters now. I stared out the window, watching Luke play in a sandbox. "Maybe I should stay in Luke's room tonight. You know, check it out. Make sure there's not some weirdo sneaking into our son's room at night." "Really? Don't you think that's a little overkill?" "What could it hurt? It's a Friday night. Mom would be happy to keep him for sleepover. They can binge watch Paw Patrol while she gorges him on popcorn and sugar cookies. Had a night to relax in a tub with a glass of wine and a good book." She tried to look annoyed, but I could tell she was intrigued by the idea. "This is ridiculous, you know," she said, half-heartedly. "Come on, you know, go a good soak, and a night to yourself sounds pretty damn good." She rolled her eyes, and I knew I'd won. "Whatever. But if your mom is busy, then it's off." But just as I had predicted, my mom was pleased as punch to take Luke for the night. She picked him up early that evening, and Claire and I enjoyed a lovely night of carry-out pizza and cheap wine. I sent her off to have a bubble bath while I watched some goofy alien show on the History Channel. Sight of its pointed white feet as it continued to glide like I loaded up my web browser and began my research. How to get rid of ghosts. The cursor blinked rapidly as if mocking me. I quickly backspaced and typed DIY exorcism. Okay, and that was worse. Cleansing spirits from your house. That was better. I hit enter. The results were mixed, as was to be expected, but I finally found a website that gave me the information I needed. A few hours later, I had a plan, and I had a name. Reginald Ward. The little shit was named Reginald after all. It appears that, unbeknownst to me or my wife, our home had been the scene of a tragic death of an 8-year-old boy in 1907. Reginald Ward, according to what I had found online, had passed away from consumption, or tuberculosis as it's more commonly referred to these days. As distressed as I was to learn that our new home was the scene of a horrific death of a child, I was even more distressed that said child was still in residence. I shuddered to think about what had befallen that child over the past decades to turn into this thing. My wife poked her head in the doorway, straddling me out of my thoughts. What are you doing? You have been here all morning. Nothing, I answered, slowly closing the laptop screen so as to not make her suspicious. Just looking at stuff online. Okay. She drew out the word while giving an odd look. Yes, she was definitely suspicious. I had to think quickly. Hey, you seemed really stressed lately. What if I had my mom keep Luke for another day and you had a spa day? Her brows perked up. Seriously? I thought you said that spa days were the most useless way to spend your money. My smile was tight. It was true. I thought it was an entire waste of money. You literally got nothing out of it. But I had to get rid of her. Oh, out of the house somehow. She couldn't be here when I was performing the cleansing. Nonsense. You deserve it. Go ahead. Give them a call and set it up. She couldn't help the grin that spread across her face. You don't have to twist my arm, she yelled as she turned and scurried downstairs to make the call. I stopped myself from mentally telling how much this little outing would cost me, and focused my attention back on the task at hand. I felt like I had a pretty good idea of how to get rid of Reggie. From what I read online, it was better to do the cleansing at night. But I didn't have that sort of time. I had to deal with this. Now, I made the quick call to my mom to see if she could keep Luke until that evening. After coordinating the time that she would drop him off, I quickly dressed and hurried downstairs. Babe, I've got to go. Run a few errands. I'll be back in a bit. Okay, I'm headed to the spa in half an hour. They had a cancellation of a deluxe package at the last minute. Isn't that great? Mentally groaned, but pasted a smile on my tense face. That's great, honey. Have fun. I grabbed my keys and hurried out to my car. 45 minutes later, I walked back into the house, like carrying my assorted purchases. Claire's car was gone, so I didn't bother calling out for her. I was all alone. Well, not alone exactly. I carried my purchases upstairs and opened the door to Luke's room. The red curtains were drawn and the room seemed just as creepy as the night before. The day had turned rainy and dreary, so what little came through the curtains gave the room the same dim glow as the previous night. I shuddered. Shutting the door, I emptied sharp nails going crazy. gave shot to my mom. What did you say? Yeah, it kind of creeped me out too, she said. He said that the others that live in the attic were mean and tried to come down and hurt Luke. He said that Reggie won't let them, that he'd protect him and keep him safe. When I tried to press on him, he clamped up. A cold chill swept over my body. The others, suddenly the rasping voice of Reggie came back to me. Want Luke. Want Luke. It was as if the floodgates opened in that moment, and I fully understood. Reggie didn't want Luke. He was trying to tell me that they wanted Luke. The others wanted Luke. Scare me into leaving. He had tried to help me to protect my son. I quickly set down my glass and snatched the blankets off my leg. Before I could stand fully up, the sound of my son's screams met my ears. The next story is called True Story of How My Daughter Knew Death Was Coming. This story happened a few years ago. I lived in a building with my daughter, who grew attached to my neighbor's husband, Teddy, as if he were her dad. One day, while talking with my neighbor's wife, my daughter, 2.5 years old at this time, came running to the door. But rather than running into my neighbor's apartment to cuddle up to Teddy, she froze at the doorway. She told his wife and I that we needed to be quiet as Teddy was sleeping. Teddy was not sleeping. He was in fact sitting on the couch watching TV. Teddy stood up and called for my daughter to come see him. Again, my daughter looked at his wife and I and told us that Teddy was sleeping and that we needed to be quiet. I could see that she was getting upset at the fact that we were laughing while telling her that Teddy's awake and wants you to sit down with him. Teddy started approaching the doorway where we were standing. My daughter began to cry and ran into our apartment screaming, "No, Teddy is sleeping." I could feel the goosebumps running across my body. The same day, my daughter went to a relative's place for a sleepover. I had invited my neighbors to come over for a bit. Teddy came over and explained how he wasn't feeling the best and how he was breathing in and out of a paper bag before coming to my apartment. I had insisted he'd go to the hospital to make sure he was alright. On the way, Teddy fell ill and asked to pull over so he could be sick on the side of the road. As he was kneeling beside the car, Teddy suffered a major heart attack and passed away while on the way to the hospital. When the service was held for Teddy, I had such a strong feeling that I had to bring my daughter with me. She brought her favorite blanket with her, of course. When my daughter and I got to the funeral home for the viewing, we were greeted by everyone in Teddy's family. They all knew who my daughter was, as Teddy used to talk about her all the time. I held my daughter close as we walked up to the casket where Teddy laid. My daughter leaned down almost as if she was going to whisper to him. She then told me that Teddy was sleeping and that he was really cold. She took her blanket and tucked Teddy in, then looked at me and said how he was happy and warm now. That night, as I sat alone in the living room, my phone began to ring. 4 or 5 rings later and still no name appeared. I quickly answered the phone in the middle of a ring, only to hear the dial tone. The call didn't even show up as an incoming call afterwards. I felt like Teddy called to say goodbye to us. It was strange that my daughter somehow knew there was something wrong with Teddy before anything even happened. A few months later, we went to visit my grandmother, who was passing away from pancreas cancer. My daughter refused to enter my grandmother's room. She kept saying how my grandmother was sleeping and that everyone should leave her to go to sleep. I instantly began to cry. Only 4 days later, I got the call that my grandmother had passed away. scared in her life. Hell, that says a lot for us living in the actual end days. Amanda, Amanda, run, she yelled. My heart skipped a beat, screwed at multiple beats. That's so when I noticed the herd of zombies coming my way. By the time I realized it was too late, Aunt Shelley had reached me and pushed me back, sending me tumbling down the hill near the bunker. I heard my mom scream again as they reached her, along with Shelley's cries and eventual screams of anguish. I woke back up to reality as I heard something outside the bunker. A woman's voice. That's not possible, right? Hello? Is anyone there? The woman said breathlessly. I jumped to my feet in disbelief and ran to the door, nearly dripping.